So, first time pitching, first look at my new Hilleberg Nallo 2. I bought this because I got the, I have a Nordisk Halland 2 lightweight. It's almost identical tent. And I mean, it's not, I haven't tensioned everything properly on here, but I just wanted to get it up in the garden. There's four more pegs to put in it. The apexes of the, or the ends of the poles rather, and give it a bit more stability. But yeah, I got this because it is a stronger tent, and I do like the design of the Halland. I also like the fact that on the end door here you've got options. You unclip this belt here and close the door, you can roll back either of the sides, so it gives you a side access or end access. I need to get some Hilleberg line, but I've got put some lines on here to hold the vent open as well. But inside, it's absolutely cavernous. It is a true two-man tent. And this is the one I'm probably going to use on the Fjällräven Classic in August. I was going to use the Halland. It is quite a chunk lighter than this. This came in at 2.5 kilograms. A couple of grams more, maybe 2.5 something. The Halland is 1.556, I think. If you add the footprint, about 300 grams. I always get them from Quincraft, as I've said before in my videos. The one, if you buy the Hilleberg footprint for this, it's 4,500 grams. It's a heavy lump. Doesn't contribute the strength of the tent as such, so I don't see the point in getting that one. Plus, it's a chunk more expensive than the ones from Lucy anyway. But yeah, what's interesting is the fly sheet on this, with the bean red label, is 1200 Kerlon. On the Halland, the fly sheet, and bear in mind, as I say, it's pretty much identical in terms of dimensions, is 500. What is it? 540 grams. This one's just over a kilo just for the fly. The inner on the Halland is about 200 grams lighter than the inner for this, and it's an almost identical inner. So if I did want to save them couple of hundred grams, which I'm not that bothered about, I could always swap the inners, because they are, it will go in here. You just have to play about with the little clips at the bottom, but all the other clips, you can fit it with this, not a problem. Well, that's it there. It's in the sand colour. Hopefully I'll get out in this next weekend. I've just ordered the footprint from Lucy at Quincraft, and we'll get out and see what's what. But looking forward to it. Possibly up Northumberland or maybe North Yorkshire. I've got options. But I mean, this does have some nice features and some that the Halland doesn't have. The Halland lately has a door on that side. That triangular panel there is the door, so that rolls back and you come in sideways here. What this has that the Halland doesn't have is this ventilation system at the back. But what you can do is unzip this and then roll these up to the clips on both sides, and then you've kind of got a curved vent at this end. So, you know, if the wind's not too bad and it's a bit warm or whatnot, you've got better ventilation. And inside the tent, you can increase the ventilation inside the inner through a triangular zip panel at the back. So I've thought about ventilation on there quite well. I saw a video on YouTube last week, and that's kind of what prompted us to go for this. There was a video of the Halland 2 lightweight wind test in a wind tunnel, and I mean, don't get us wrong, it's a decent, it stood up decent. It's like, I think 55 mile an hour they went up to. This front end bowed in quite significantly at that, but everything else stood pretty well. This one, there's a video of a guy actually pitching the tent in measured 69 mile an hour wind, so like quite a chunk more, and he manages to put the tent up, and there was significantly less blowing in at this front end, even though it was like 14 mile an hour more. So the poles on this are, for the two together, they're about 150 grams heavier than in the Halland. And I'm thinking, I think the Halland ones, because they're Dacks as well. Dack feather like greens, I think. I think these are 9 mils. And I think the other ones, the Nordisk ones, I think they're 8 or 8.5. I haven't measured the die on them. But yeah, I think that's the difference. So those poles are lighter, therefore probably not as strong as, well, they won't be as strong as these ones. And so really it was the extra strength that I've picked this up for. And that wind test was the thing that swayed us a little bit. So anyway, I just thought I'd do a little quick video just to show you it set up. And as soon as I get the footprint, that'll get fitted. Probably when I camp next weekend. But yeah, excited to get out in it. Should be good. I've brought the tents away, packed everything away. I mentioned a few things in the video, weight-wise and things like that. So I decided to weigh everything to give you more accurate information about the component parts. So, Hilleberg Nallo. The fly weighed 1,058 grams. The inner was 756 grams. The poles altogether was 317 grams. The larger red tabbed one, 171 grams. The smaller one, 146. The pegs, 186 grams. There's 16 of them. They're 11 grams each, or thereabouts. The pole bag is 14 grams. Peg bag, 11 grams. Main bag, 45 grams. And the pole repair kit you get, which is a small pole repair sleeve plus a full pole section, individual section, was 35 grams. That gave us a total weight of 2,422 grams for the Nallo 2. The footprint from Lucy at Quincraft is 381 grams. So if I use that footprint up, the one I'll get from Al, it'll be very, very similar in weight, maybe a few grams lighter, because I think it is a little bit shorter. the vestibule on the Nallo 2, I think, is a little bit shorter than the one on the Halland. But it's going to be much of a muchness. The total weight was 2,843 grams. So it's not, like I say, it's not a light tent, but it's a lot stronger. It has to be a lot stronger, just because of the poles and the fly material, to be fair. Because the weight on the Halland, the fly was 524 grams. So the Nallo 2 fly is more than double the weight of the fly. And like I say, they are almost identical size tents. The dimensions are 1 centimeter different here and there. So 524 grams for the fly. The inner is 567 grams. So that's like, what, 189 grams lighter than the inner for the Hilleberg. So if I was going to get really precious about weight, I could swap the inners, because they will work, they'll fit within each other. So that would bring the Nallo down to 2,650 or something like that. I'm not really bothered about 200 grams, 189 grams. No, not really. The Halland poles, 233 grams for the pair. The gold pole, which is the larger one, I believe, yep, is 127 grams. The grey pole, the smaller one's 106. So again, not that much in it individually in terms of the poles. The bigger pole is 50 grams heavier on, 44 grams heavier on the Nallo. And the other pole is 40 grams heavier than it is on the Halland. So I haven't measured the diameters on them, but I'm pretty sure the Halland uses 8 mil, whereas the Nallo uses 9 mil. Somebody else, if someone out there knows, then feel free to correct us on that. The pegs, they come in at 146 grams. There is a couple less pegs, I believe, on the Halland than there is on the Nallo, but the pegs are 10 grams each as opposed to 11 for the the Hilleberg pegs. The pole bag, 16 grams on the Halland, so that's heavier than the Hilleberg. The peg bag is 11 grams, identical. The main bag's 44, it's 1 gram lighter. And the pole repair kit that you get is literally just a small sleeve. You don't get a pole section, and that's 16 grams. And that gives you a grand sum total for the Halland of 1557 grams. With the footprint of 381, that gives you 1938 grams. So it's kicking the backside off 2 kilograms. And that basically means the Hilleberg is 900 grams heavier. But as I mentioned in the video, like you see the wind test, and it's quite significant how different they perform, even for, you know, almost identical tents. The vestibule end, which is the end you pitch into the wind, that was bored in a lot at sort of 55 miles an hour in the test for the Halland. And the test for the Hilleberg, like I say, they've basically got a big industrial fan, and it's out in a field. The guy actually pitches it up while it's getting blown all over the knot end, gets it pitched up, gets inside it, comes back outside of it, and it, as I say, it's significantly less deflection. And he doesn't even put all the guy lines in, you know, and it still stood, you know, solid, pretty solid. I was quite impressed by the how well it stood up, given that it was 14 mile an hour more on the wind side. So that's quite significant for me. Now, as I say, that video was kind of, I've been looking at them for a while, but it was kind of the thing that sort of tipped us over the edge. I was like, yeah, okay, I'll get one. So, I mean, I've got some decisions to make in the next few weeks. As I say, I want to try and get out in the Nallo next weekend, give that a run out. And then following that, I've got a chunk of decisions to make about what I'm going to do tents-wise, because I've got too many tents, to be honest with you. And I will end up buying more tents. I'm always the same. I'm a bit of a tent nerd, to be honest. So do I get rid of the Halland? I don't know, because I really quite like that tent. But I've got two tents almost identical now, so I don't know. Not sure. I mean, I do think I'm probably going to hang on to the Solo. I will learn not to say that. I'm probably going to hang on to the Solo, and I'm probably going to move on the Vern, to be honest with you. There was an interesting video I watched yesterday. I was sent a guy pitching the Vern 1 in. When he pitched it, it was like 40 mile an hour winds maybe, and then the wind gradually builds over the night, and it was around about the 55 mile an hour mark, I think it was, when he decided to bail. 50 or 55, I can't remember. He decided to bail, so he packed up. And in the process of packing up, the centre crossing pole snapped. There's a few reasons why I think it happened. It was interesting that at the beginning of the video, he shows like the pole section, well, obviously when he's back at home. And part of him showing you that, he shows that the pole is bent on the top end. There's like a bend in it. Well, to be honest with you, when you watch further into the video, as he's pitching the tent, you can see that pole's already bent. So I don't know how that's happened, but that wasn't caused by that wind, I don't think, because it's very clearly already bent. But that's not where it snaps. It snaps down near where you've got the heavy duty part of the sleeve, a little bit further up than that is where it gives up the ghost, and it properly snaps. It was when he just got out of the tent, the door was open, and there was fairly constant heavy wind, and then there was a few big gusts as well. So I just wonder whether the gust has given that bit extra pressure when the door's open, that it's kind of lifted the tent and caused the extra pressure. But the other thing I noticed, I don't think he was pitched like right end on into the wind. I think he was slightly side on, like not fully side on, but a little bit. So because early in the video when you're watching, it looks like one of the side panels is getting pushed in a lot more. whether that's contributed, I don't know. The other thing that struck us as a bit strange, I mean, I haven't messaged the guy or anything like that, and I'm not trying to criticise the guy. I'd say it's his fault. I mean, tents can fail, it is what it is. But the thing I found strange was on the side guy outlines, the ones that come off the centre pole to the side, there's like two lines. Now, well, personally, I always pitch them together through one peg, so that they're both coming down to the one point. Other people like to pitch them separate, and there's no right or wrong, I don't think. But what I noticed was, like, if that's the centre pole going over the tent, he had one guy line like this, and that, like, the lower one was like straight, and the upper one was going like that. And I'm just wondering whether that pulling towards the wind there, and the rest of the tent pulling that way, whether that's caused, I don't know. Like I say, I'm not an accident investigator or a structural expert by any stretch of the imagination, but I just found that a bit curious. Perhaps somebody else out there has got a bit more knowledge of these kinds of things and can maybe shed some light on that, but it failed anyway. And then I believe there's another video going to make an appearance later today with a Vern2 that had a couple of tent poles failed. I'm not going to say who it is, because I might get this one on before they do theirs, and I don't want to, like, steal their thunder or anything. But so I believe Nortent are looking into either bigger die poles or different poles. I'm not sure, but anyway, so there'll be a couple of surfacing, and like I say, that one's already up there. I'll probably put a link in the description to it, so then you can have a watch and make your own mind up. But that's not the reason why I'm thinking of selling the Vern1, because I do really like the tent. I think it's a cracking tent. Was having a discussion with a few people in a group I'm in yesterday, and like on Facebook, and I mentioned in there, like, the Vern1 is a good tent. Like, there's loads of people battered on for weeks and weeks about how it's the Hilleberg solo killer and all this kind of stuff, and it isn't. Like, honestly, to be fair about it, just being honest, it is not better than a solo. When I posted my comparison video, I was saying, like, it could be. It's too early to tell. I mean, I pitched that one in the garden and nobody really used it at that point, because I was very fortunate. I think when it first came on their website and I ordered it, I think I got in with the first batch. I think I was one of the few people who bought the tent who got it at the same time as the socials people who were getting it for free from Nortent. So I had it, like, as early as everyone else, and that's not because I'm special. Well, my mother might say I'm a different kind of special, but it was just, I think, pure luck that, you know, I ordered and I got in there, because I know some other people who ordered the same day have got it later. But anyway, that's by the by. So I did mention in that early video in the garden that could it be competition to this solo? Yes, it could. Is it? We don't know. But the more I look at it, it isn't. It's right. So what I'd said in one of the comments, and there's a few people seem to agree with this, which is rare when I see something, people generally disagree, but there was a few people agreed with this. So again, and these people have had the Verns as well. So what I'd said was, if you haven't got Hilleberg money to spend, the Vern1 is a cracking option. Because it's like half the price-ish or thereabouts. It is a good tent. It's a cracking tent. For the price point that it's at, it's a great tent. But if you have got Hilleberg money to spend, you're buying a Hilleberg. There's not even, I don't think there's even a debate there. I mean, some people might disagree. That's fine. That such is their want, but I honestly do believe that if you've got the kind of money you need to buy a Hilleberg solo, you're buying a Hilleberg solo. You're not buying a Vern1 if you haven't quite got that to scrape together. And no judgment, by the way, about anyone, how much money they've got. I really don't care. Like, it's not important. But if you haven't got that kind of money to spend, then a Vern1's a hell of an option. There are other tents in the ballpark of a Vern1 that you might consider. I mean, I've not used one. I know a few people who have, and I've seen mixed reports about it, but Terranova Pioneer 2, possibly. You can pick up a Southern Cross 2 for that kind of money. You know, not brand new, because Terranova prices are just stupid. But and if you want to go a little bit more budget, Wild Country Helm 2 is a Belton tent, but it's about £300. You can pick one up for about less than £200 if you look about. You'll find one cheaper. That'll be second hand, mind, but the Helm 2 is an absolute Belton tent for the price point. If you made that tent £500-600, it's a shit tent. That's where you gotta look at these things. It depends how much money you're spending. But the Helm 2 is a bloody good tent. And you've got other stuff like your Van Gogh Banshees and that. Budget options that do very, very well. I mean, if you're paying big money for a tent, you're not getting a million miles more than you're getting for a budget, some of the budget tents, because there is some shit budget tents, let's be fair about it. But if you bought a Helm 2 and you put it next to a Hilleberg Solo, yes, the Hilleberg Solo beats it. Like, if you're playing top trumps, the Hilleberg Solo wins everything except price. It's stronger, and, well, weight, sorry. Well, actually, no. If it's a red label Solo, the Helm's about the same weight. But the Vern, as we know, is, especially with the ground sheet, is like a 3 kilogram tent. If you've got a Helm 2 with a footprint, is about 2.5, I'm going to say, 2.6 maximum, so it's lighter. It packs smaller, you know, definitely quite a bit smaller. You get the compact version. And I've used the Helm in 40 plus mile an hour winds, and it's been cracking. It genuinely has. Would it go much more than that? I wouldn't like to see it, because I've seen them fail as well. But I've seen loads of different tents fail for various reasons. Most of the time, it's because it's been pitched wrong. It's not always the tent. In fact, I would say it's rarely the tent, unless you've bought a cheap tent and deliberately gone out. Because you see, some of these channels are deliberately going out in really heavy storm conditions. Like, you'll get some storm forecasts that they say, oh, it's going to be 100 mile an hour winds. And people are going out just because they want to create content, like, to try and make it exciting. Personally, I think they're idiots, because they're not only putting themselves at risk, but they're also putting the mountain rescue lads at risk, which, you know, unforgivable, really. But if you get caught out in something, that can happen to anybody. We can all get caught out. And in this country, that can happen quite easily. But people deliberately going out in really, really, really bad conditions, it's like stupidity, I think, to be honest. But that's a separate subject altogether. But like I say, when you buy a tent, there's a million options out there now. Like, there's way more tents available than there was, like, even 5 years ago. I think COVID just caused an explosion in the range of tents, not just in terms of models by certain companies, but in terms of the number of companies as well. It's just exploded, which is a good thing, because the more places, it's kind of like a pyramid, the more people you've got making different tents, the more the quality goes up, because I do think tents generally are better now than they were. The Chinese, well, they've basically just copied a load of other tents, pretty good ones. I'm very, very surprised, I'll be honest with you, that someone like Nature Hike hasn't ripped off a Solo. They've ripped off the Alak. That's what a Cloud Peak 2 is. And Wild Country have, Terranova have just done that as well, because they've just brought one out. Can't remember its name. But that's, you look at it, and it's their version of an Alak 2. Similar weight, similar price as well. They're asking £950 for it, and I'm just like, really? Like, no. But it is what it is. But like I say, the Hilleberg Nallo, I just wanted to get it up in the garden, have a look at it, and so there's the weights for it and everything. I'm looking to try and make more videos. I mean, that said, after next weekend, I'll be back in Europe for 3 weeks, so I'll struggle to make any content while I'm out there, but I'm sure none of you will lose any sleep over that. So I'll leave you with that then. Thanks for watching. Thanks for the support I've had as well with my other videos. It's been nice to see, and I've gone from like, oh, I think I had about 11 subscribers, which are all like pals, to I'm not far off 250 now in the space of a few weeks. So I'm really pleased about that. The comments keep coming in, so I mean, if you like the content, you know, hit the like button, hit the subscribe, and notifications if you really want. If you don't. It is what it is. But until the next time, thanks very much.